Order.
Madam Clerk, can we have the roll call?
Tom Duffy.
Here.
John Wigheimer.
Here.
Stacy Hessel.
Here.
Brian Bissonette. Chris Rusk.
Here.
You have a quorum.
Okay, thank you. Let's stand for the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Madam Clerk, on the certification of the compliance.
This meeting has been noticed to the public and news media as required by Section 19.84 of the Wisconsin statutes.
Okay, thank you. The agenda's been set. Anybody have any additions or corrections? Seeing no hands, I assume they don't. We'll go on to public comments. Anybody here that wants to be heard at this time rather than when their item comes up on the agenda? I don't see any, so let's move on then to the minutes of the previous meeting.
I'll make a motion to accept the minutes.
Thank you, John. Second by, okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Very well, they're approved. Okay, moving on to the Surrey County Ag Fair.
Yep. Morning, Rick Christian, Surrey County Fair President. Our update from the 2023 fair, our numbers over 2022 are up about 1,000 people for the week, overall the weekend. The additions that we made to the hillside for seating was well received. It ended up giving people in wheelchairs a chance to come right up as close as they could be, very conveniently. So that was a really good addition. We're going to expand on that and make it more, some more handicap seating this year. And then redoing lighting in our pit. There's a bunch of little stuff we're bringing more fill in for in the cow barn, because when it rains, all the water comes, flows in where the cows are at, and they got to clean up after that mess. So we're changing that. A lot of little things that we're trying to improve on. So I'm just make it better. But it was a good year. The weather was great for it. We're pretty much all planned with a couple little things for 2024 too.
So budget wise, you got a little surplus, or how do you?
Not so much the surplus. We're always, a little bit, but not much. It's always right. There, it figures out. And when we do have a surplus, then we try and like whatever we have, and we try and add back into it, whether we bring some of the stuff we took out to get out of a hole. And so, or just improvements or getting a little bit better act for kid shows or family tents, stuff like that.
So how about the carnival part of it? How was that?
The carnival's good. We've had them now for, I believe, 4 years. They come from Hurley, and they do a pretty good job. So he's that the guy that puts it on. I think in our contract, he's only contracted to bring 6 or 7 large rides. And this year they packed in rides every possible place they could at the fairgrounds. So it was filled up. And then they add in little filler bounce houses and stuff like that.
So they'll be back next year?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. With them, our major things like the carnival and the bull riding are our biggest things. So I signed 3-year contracts with them.
Okay, good. Anybody any questions, guys? Okay. Oh, I'm sorry, Lynn.
The guy that's got some video. So I'm going to move this out and relog it on an overhead. I don't see video on the OBS either.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Nora, you're on.
All right. Okay. We're back on. We're ready to go. So Lori Baltrush is with Extension, and just a couple updates from our educators this time around. Ariga has done some real colors with a women's retreat. She's doing a housing study that is trying to get some information to Andy toward the end of the or middle of this month. She's been working on some surveys with Spider Lake and a couple grants with LCO that are looking pretty promising. Donna has been working hard on new enrollments, a couple Clover Bud clubs that we're pretty excited about to get the young ones in first. So once they're in 4-H, they tend to stay. So we want to keep going with that. Working with the fair, thinking about some discovery days. trying to guide Market Animal and some tough decisions that they're working on. Has looked at doing an AmeriCorps position, which would provide a little extra support. 4-H leaders council would be helping support that position, so that could bring up some other additional support for 4-H in Sawyer County. And she's also been working on the Heart of the North, which some of you are familiar with, legislative days that happened in February. And so last year there were 7 youth that were recruited for that day, but it's not really a day. It's a lot of prep that goes into that. But this year there are 14, so we've doubled the numbers for youth. It does give them a chance to learn a lot more about our legislative process and work with some people to have youth voice represented for some crucial things moving forward. So Kim continues to do bingo size and strong bodies and some education in the schools. And Kevin, as if you have seen him at all, he always calls himself the Vegetable Santa during this time around and brings a lot of vegetables from the Spooner Ag Station out into the communities for people to be able to utilize. So works pretty closely with the Foodwise ladies, all ladies right now, to get that into our communities and do some education around food. In particular vegetables. There's a Grazers conference coming up too this Saturday at the Shell Lake Conference Center. So there's the 11th annual one. They're packed full in their kind of little elbow room. So if you've not registered and you're thinking about the Grazers conference, might be full now, but that's coming up too. And that's maybe enough. I was thinking that maybe you haven't heard from Kevin in a while, so I might invite him come back for the December meeting if you'd like to hear a little bit more about what's happening with that educator. Sound good?
Good.
Okay.
Okay, thanks, Lori. Anybody, any questions, anybody? Okay, good. Thank you. Okay, moving on to Haywood Lakes.
Good morning. Okay,
good morning, Sherry.
So October was a very exciting month for Haywood Lakes. So we had a premiere party because we had Discover Wisconsin was here this summer filming, and it was very exciting. We actually got to see the episode on the big screen at the Park Theater. So it was very fun. It was very fun to see that episode on the big screen. We also held our annual dinner on October 18th and had a very nice turnout. And then we've been looking at ways to like save money or, you know, just make sure we're spending our money the way it should be spent. And so what we did was we had a separate website for atvhayward.com. We're still going to use that in our advertising, but we're just going to direct it to haywardlakes.com. So we'll still use it, but it will go right to haywardlakes.com, and it'll save us thousands of dollars because we don't have a second website that we have to maintain and pay for and all of that good stuff. So I was asked to put together the things that we do for Southern Sawyer County. So I updated this. I've done this in the past. We've been working with Southern Sawyer County. We have marketing partnership with the Winter Area Chamber of Commerce. And I don't know how much you want me to go through this, but since I had to put it together, I thought I would present it. You know, do you want me to kind of go through it? It's a big document.
Who asked for that?
So some of the members of Haywood Lakes is working with the Winter Area Chamber of Commerce, so they asked me to put this together.
Oh, okay. I thought it was important. Okay.
Oh, no. Nope. It was internal, and I put it together, so I thought I would share it. It's just some of the things that we do. We do really for the whole area, but just to kind of highlight what we're doing and how we're getting things done. You know, we help pay for a lot of different things like road bicycle maps, fall color tour. We pay for that whole brochure, which includes the whole county. We do trail conditions for the whole county. Travel Wisconsin. We help if anybody has an event or a business, lodging, dining, we are the main contact for that. So if you have anything you want added to the travelwisconsin.com, which is the state tourism website. We put that information in for the whole county. You do not have to be a member, or you just give us a call and we'll get you in. Just some of the things that we put together. Calendar events, anybody can be on the calendar events. You don't have to be a member of anything. We sponsored a few things down in Southern Sawyer County. We do, during the major events, we do actually give out lodging that you don't have to be a member, because we need your lodging availability. So like for Berkey and Lumberjacks and stuff, we will.
I would imagine, like, do you have any idea what percentage is in the southern part of the county? I would imagine most activities north, northwest in the county.
What's the question?
How much activity?
Oh, they have a lot of activity.
Do that?
Okay. Oh yeah, yes, yes. Nice. They do. Yes, yep, a lot of events and.
Awesome. Yeah.
Yep.
Good. Okay. Any questions, guys?
All right,
good, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, moving on to economic development. Northwest Regional. Sheldon is not here. Economic Development Corporation.
Not here.
You want to make a report?
We have a meeting Thursday at 1 o'clock. I don't have any other report.
Okay. Anything new with the director?
As far as I know, that
Okay, let's go to the library. Molly, you want to go first?
Library?
Yeah.
It's Ann Larson. I'm the assistant director. I'm here today. I know she sent you her reports. Also, I put on your desk what we did last month. We had the Halloween Spooktacular that was attended by 66 families. We had it on a Saturday this year. I had put out a small poll asking families if they like after school or on Saturday. The majority of people said Saturday. Unfortunately though too, it was less attended than the after school, so I just might switch it because I think people think their Saturdays are free, and then it's a lot of, you know, family activities or clean the yard or what have you. So next year we may be switching it back to during the week and after school. It's a drop-in event where people can spend 10 minutes or they can spend, you know, the whole 3 hours that we have. This year it was during Wisconsin Science Festival. Every year we try to do something for that, and that is we do some kind of a STEM, that's science, technology, engineering, and math related activity. This year we merged the two events, so a lot of our events were based on science and technology, engineering, and math. So they did things like they built structures, and they tried to build the tallest structure out of toothpicks and Halloween gummy pumpkins. They shot at targets, texture. They also had to they made mummies, and they had to guess how long of a piece of yarn they had to use to wrap the mummy. They also made bat rockets with a straw, so they can angle the bat, the straw with a bendy straw, and blow the bat and see how far it could go depending on the angle. They made spider marshmallows out of pretzels, Oreos, etc. The families seem to have a lot of fun, and then also what we have afterwards is a stuffed animal sleepover. The animal sleepover, and this year they did everything that the kids did. The kids really enjoyed it. I posted it on Facebook so they got to see throughout the night and through the weekend what they did. And the next day they picked up their favorite stuffy, and we told them don't leave a stuffy that the kid needs to sleep with, because otherwise they won't sleep. So. Let's see, and they got a picture of their stuffy and wearing a prop. So that was last month. This month, I gave you, it's actually not November at the library, it's Dinovember. A lot of fun activities, take and make craft. We got a puppet. A lot of different things planned. We had a tea party that was supposed to be last Saturday. Due to illness, some of the moms that helped me from kits, with the illnesses going around with the kids, they weren't able to help because we're going to have these huge blow-up dinosaurs and we're going to teach manners to the kids, how to, you know, eat correctly, sit correctly, and the dinosaurs are going to show exactly how to do it or really not what to do. So a lot of fun activities. They're going to vote on their favorite dinosaurs. They're during also during a break from school over Thanksgiving. I've got a lot of fun activities planned, including bingo, and then teen crafts, adult and teen craft night, upcycling, teaching how to upcycle old crayons into jewelry. And for adults, we'll be showing Jurassic Park. And for kids, it's Jurassic World Camp Cretaceous. And also for the kids, it would be Ice Age, Dawning of the Dinosaurs, and other little activities. And then the beginning of December, we're gonna teach letter writing to the kids. So they're gonna write a letter to Santa and get a secret letter sent back from Santa. Any questions? Yes, Stacy.
I'm just wondering how many books, I mean, you talk about the activities, which is awesome, and then you're getting the kids in your library, but can you give us like facts on how many books are checked out each month? You know, could you add that to your report or you or Molly?
I could definitely. I don't have that on the top of my head.
Nope, that's okay.
But the numbers are going up. That's no problem. I can add it with no problem at all. And I can tell you meeting room usage if you wanted. And also our study rooms get used quite a bit. Matter of fact, we've got a student using one quite often. And some days, especially during the summer, it's like, I wish we had 10 more study rooms.
Mm-hmm. How many? No, I think the activities are great. I just,
I know.
The
intent
of the library is
I agree.
Read, so, okay.
Yep.
All right.
Yep. No, our bread and butter are the books. This is just to get the kids involved and then the families too. So, all right. I will add numbers to the report. Thank you.
How many will show up for the tea party?
I don't know. To give you an example, is this year for the Spooktacular, we had 66 total people, that's adults and kids, with about two-thirds being children. But like last year, I had 120 people show up at the Spooktacular, almost double. So I try to plan for about 75 kids, and I have to say, you know, things run out when they do. So.
And parents come too?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. We encourage the parents to come and interact. You'll see with the photos.
And so where do you house them all over there? Do you have enough room for a
Well, like something with the Spooktacular, I wish we had a bigger meeting room or two like we had hoped, but they go between the meeting room and then the children's room and do activities there.
Wow, good.
So, yeah.
Okay, anybody have any questions?
All right, okay. I will definitely add the numbers. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, now we'll hear from Winter.
I was speaking with Ann earlier. The year is going by so fast, and it just seems like libraries are, you know, they're increasing in their numbers and their number of visits. I did not know you were going to ask that question, Stacy, but last night I actually wrote down the statistics for circulation. And so I don't have Hayward's, but I was looking at all of the libraries in Northern Waters, and I feel like we're post-COVID, where families and people are utilizing the libraries in person more now. So I know for our statistics with circulation, last year total, we had 9,044 items that were circulated. That's not just books. We have DVDs, kits, puzzles. Technology that gets circulated. This year, right now, at the end of October, we're at 8,311 items, and we average about 850 a month. So I know that we'll surpass last year's numbers. So we're seeing, and I think Ann can agree too, that we're seeing an increase in people attending activities as well. I know libraries are really good about doing make and takes, where people could take things home and make them, or they can make them at the library and take them home. But in-person programming is increasing. I know for youth and for adults, I know in the winter library, I don't know, I invite you all to come down to our library because our library is 1,200 square feet, maybe a little bit bigger than this conference room. And so we are tight spaced and we're constantly moving things. Like my office is a cubby in the back, but it's also the children's area. So we're constantly moving things so we can shift around and make room for our activities and fit everybody in. I've been talking about our programming, some new programming that we've put into our library. We've brought back our story hour on Fridays. It's been highly successful. We have kids club on Fridays because the after school program meets Monday through Thursday from 3:30 to 5:30 at the school. So Friday evenings we thought, well, we need a place for an opportunity for youth to come to because, you know, daycares, we've had daycares close in winter. And so I don't want to say that we babysit, but we offer programming for families if they need a place for their youth to attend. And that has been highly successful as well. And I mean, it would be nice to have a bigger space, but that's a total separate issue. I looked at our budget and we're on target for our budget of where we thought we would be for this year. So that's good. We have another fundraiser coming up. I know Homespun Holidays is the Saturday after Thanksgiving every year in winter, and it brings in thousands of people to do local shopping. And at the school, they have like the whole school full of vendors. And we have a booth there which we sell raffle tickets for. So we will have one more fundraiser this year. We always do a book giving tree. It costs nothing for the library other than the staff time. But we have donors, public and private, or you know, businesses and private donors, that youth can request a book that they would like for Christmas, and they are paid for through donations. And so we order the books, pay out of this special fund that we have strictly just for the book giving tree, so that every youth or every parent that wants a book for their child, they get what they, you know, ask for. They get to pick out their own book. I think we have usually between 130 and 150 requests. So it's just something that we facilitate. It's not extra costing other than, like I said, staff time, and they actually love doing it. We wrap up the books and the kids are happy, and so are the parents. Let's see, I'm looking at what else. Just attended a conference last week. I received a grant sponsorship so I could go to the Wisconsin Library Association conference. So I attended a lot of sessions on rural libraries and programming and opportunities and networking. So that was really wonderful. I've been at Winter for 13 years, and this was my first year I could actually have the opportunity and flexibility to go. So that was a wonderful professional development for me, and was able to bring back some new ideas and get refreshed in some of the thoughts that we can do and activities we can do in libraries. And as usual, each December we spend a day at the library where youth can come to the library, participate in cookie decorating, crafts, and whatever, while parents maybe could get away and go do some shopping or whatever for Christmas. But it's just a fun day, and we have Mrs. Claus that comes and spends time with them there. So that's in the planning process. And as always, even though we can give reports, which I didn't this month and I apologize, but for you to read, things always change because new ideas come up, and it's just kind of exciting. So I'm really excited. I want to tell you my first few years in this position. We always said that there was a busy season and a slow season. So it's been busy all the time. We've just had that discussion at our staff meeting. We don't have slow seasons anymore, which is nice. It's a positive thing. So that just means that the libraries are seen as, you know, a resource in the communities. And so that's exciting for us when we can have staff meetings and just talk about how super busy we are all the time. So we appreciate the funding again. And if you have questions, I can try to answer them.
Last month you mentioned you have student help for after hours. How is that going?
Oh, it's really good. That's on Fridays from 3:30 to 5:30. And we have a couple of certified teachers that help facilitate that program. We did, we don't request or ask for signups for that program, but we may have to relook at that because it's huge. I mean, we have 15 to 20 youth, which doesn't seem like a lot, but I'm not kidding you, our space is
an issue. What age group are these kids?
They're anywhere from kindergarten through high school.
Wow.
We have, I believe, one high schooler that comes, but she comes just as a helper. She's like, oh, I don't really have to do this, but she just likes to be there with some of the other youth. We do have a couple of families that come because of social interaction. They're like in kindergarten and they need to, or younger, trying to get them to socialize. And we do have a bilingual family where they want to have just that verbal interaction with English speaking people. So, and some homeschool families that participate.
Good. Anybody else have any questions? Thank you, guys. We have really active libraries in the county, which is great.
They are active, and they're a great resource. You know, obviously, I'm an advocate for the libraries, but it is one place where all ages can go to and participate. So that's what's really awesome.
Okay. Thank you much. Okay, let's go on to motorized trail.
Good morning. Kathy from the Sawyer County Alliance. Within the last few weeks, I attended the AWSC Fall Workshop and the NORTAC meeting. AWSC represents over 600 snowmobile clubs and over 40,000 members. Our Fall Workshop offered seminars on trail first aid, SNARS, which is a system used to track grooming, legislative issues, clean engine development, and a lot more. I've got a frog in my throat this morning, I'm sorry. 413 people attended this convention. That's down, we usually have close to 600 people. Last year's snowmobile trail pass sales brought in $4,239,000, which is money used to maintain the trails. And then at the NORTAC meeting, we finalized a motorized sports user survey, which we should be publishing this week. It's going to be a long-running survey and gather data from both snowmobile and ATV seasons. We're pretty excited about that. And that concludes my report for today, unless you have questions.
How about your trail access? How is that coming? Are you satisfied now with where you are? Or?
What do you mean trail access?
As far as your snowmobiles and four-wheelers and side-by-sides.
Well, it's always a work in progress.
Pardon?
It's always a work in progress.
Okay.
We have clearly more work to do. One of the problems or the issues we run into with the snowmobile trail system is segments run across private property. Over time, private property gets sold, and then like a new owner doesn't want a snowmobile trail. They have a different use for that property in mind, and then it requires us to reroute. It's so those things are the majority of what we work on, our committee works on over the winter.
Good. How many groomers do you have?
We've sold a few. I'm not on the equipment committee. I should know this. We had 14. I think we've sold two to buy new equipment because it gets a lot of use. So the Alliance owns all the equipment, the clubs use it.
But you're in good shape with groomers.
We are. The problem I think most of the clubs run into is housing the equipment because our county is such a large landmass area. So we don't get funding for that. So it's a lot of fundraising for clubs trying to come up with buildings to house that expensive equipment.
So, and are you doing LCO's grooming too, or do you have your own?
No, they do theirs.
We do their trails as well.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Any questions, guys?
Didn't one of your volunteers just win an award for the chamber? Was that the Snow Trails Club?
Tom Witt, maybe.
No, it was a lady. Darlene.
Oh, Darlene. Okay. Yeah, we have a lot of awards floating all over. I'm sorry.
No, it was the Chamber Annual Dinner. So it was noticed that
that your group and the volunteers are doing well, and she won an award just for her part in that. So congratulations.
She has been in the Alliance, I think, for 24 years. She heads up our fundraising committee, and she is a workaholic. She's single-handedly put on a lot of events. I mean, there are a few other people on that committee, but Darlene is quite a powerhouse within the Alliance, and she's very dedicated.
Good job.
Okay, thank you. Okay, let's go to non-motorized. We have a report from Ben. I've sent you all a copy of that. Basically, most all of the events of the Berkey are filled. They earlier thought they'd have 12,000 racers, then they went to 13,000, then 14,000, and now it'll be 14,500. This year they started a new race called the Ski She Do, which is a race for women only. They have a camp, first of all, then they have a race, and they started at 150 racers. They're now 100 over that waiting list. It's been great. Last week they started the snow machines going, made snow for 3 or 4 days, basically to get the bugs out of the system, and that's ready to go. The next event's going to be the Thanksgiving camp called the Turkey Berkey. So they'll have snow for early skiing at that time. So, okay, let's go on then to the broadband update, Andy.
The current round of grant applications, the capital projects round, ends tomorrow, applications review. We have a few applications going in from Surrey County that we provided letters of support and a partnership agreement with, a couple from Mosaic, one for Charter and one for Novato. Okay. So this is kind of a smaller intermediary round with some federal funds that came to the state. And then the next round will be the BEAD funds after the first of the year.
Okay, thank you. Okay, just a quick update on LCO. Chris, do you want to cover that as far as the clinic?
When I spoke to them, they had all their concrete footings in for the entire expanse of the building, and they had done the basement part and the floor. Floor is on the rest of the building we're going in today, and then construction we'll start to see stuff going
on. And you're, if you have a schedule, you're on
they're schedule. They're on schedule, yeah, schedule. And I think it's May of 25, actually.
Oh, actually.
Schedule for opening, yeah.
Are you referencing the clinic?
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't know what was being built. So.
Okay, yeah. Good. All right, thank you. Okay, the Historical Society. Good to see you again.
Well, we're now officially in our winter hours, which is basically from Labor Day to Memorial Day. We're only open on Thursdays from 10 to 2, although this year officially we're closed completely in November and December because of all the holidays and such. But if the weather is nice, we have one of our volunteers, Hazel Johnjack, who likes to come in and open up anyway. And we're also open by appointment. I have a group coming this Thursday. We now have a logging sled in the front yard, and very soon it'll be loaded with logs. Just waiting for the people to come since it's a volunteer that's doing it. But before winter, that'll be loaded with logs. We just had our quarterly meeting, and we had a few changes gone. We were supposed to have Famous Dave as our speaker, but about 10 minutes before the meeting started, I just found out that he couldn't come. So instead of Famous Dave, we had what he calls an infamous James, Dave's son. He was a very good speaker. And also, everyone that was there, probably 60 or 70 people, got a copy of Famous Dave's cookbook, Barbalicious, which sells for $25. So everybody was pretty happy, and we'll still have Dave in the future. He's a very busy person. I mean, he had two appointments, two speaking engagements for that night. The next day he had to be in Iowa. So he's busy. And found out that he no longer owns the old Southern Barbecue. It's his son James that owns them. So, Dave just basically have his place here, as far as I know. Other than that, like I say, this is our slow time of year. Although, and we did, we just lost one of our longtime volunteers too, Roger Chuddy, and his funeral is Thursday, so I'll be at the museum and miss that. And hopefully, come January, when we're open once a week, that's, if it isn't like last winter, when it was an ice rink at the museum, you couldn't even get from your car to the building. It was so much ice. But we're hoping for a little better weather. And this was the first year that we did trunk or treat. And I never realized there were that many kids in Sawyer County. 2.5 hours of steady stream. We were there an hour and a half, and there was still a line a block and a half long waiting to get into the parking lot. It was a little brisk, but it was fun. So we'll probably be doing it next year because we had a good time. You see a lot of you little kids, even up to teenagers, I guess you're not too old for candy ever. Even a lot of the parents took some, you know, like, so, but other than that, for the, our January speaker is going to be a lady that wrote a book called, it's about the history of Sawyer County and Hayward, and it's a bunch of stories, like it has the story about Joe Saltis and the game wardens and all the encounters they had with each other. And got a section about the hideout, you know, explaining who the owners were there and such, and other about the logging industry, about the resort industry. So it's just, each chapter is a little bit about something different, and it's written by Pat Lacey from Sawyer County. But it's a very good book, and we sell them at the museum now at $20 for her book. But she'll be our January speaker. Hopefully we'll have Famous Dave maybe come in April if he's open. Other than that, like I say, we're in winter hours now, so things are slowing down.
And, how many logs will you have on that sled?
I don't know the number, but a reasonable amount, not like those pictures you see where they're stacked 15 feet high, you know, that was just for the camera. We have to put something on there that looks like a real load and that is safe. You know, we don't want some kids climbing up on it and having the whole thing come down.
Yeah.
So it'll be a reasonable size load and will be fastened down.
Yeah, it'll be an attraction for people to climb on it, no doubt.
But
Stacy, remember that, stay off it.
Okay.
Yeah. How on your trunk or treat did you have candy offered at the Historical Society, or
no,
were you in town?
We were at the parking lot next to the bank and the post office there, but it was like 50 different groups there.
Good for you.
So, but it was fun. I say first time we've done it.
Good. All right. Thank you for coming. Anybody have any questions? All right. Good job. Keep it up.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Let's see, future agenda items. Anything else we should have on the agenda that we don't have? No. Andy, you want to bring us up to date? Anything else going on?
I guess maybe just the Economic Development Corporation, the annual meeting is going to be December 14th. Okay. You'll see information about that. Other than that, no.
Okay. All right, thanks everyone for coming. Have a good day. Oops. Yep, you're on.
Sorry. So through October, we've 56,387 items that have been checked out. Last year total, which would add three more months, it was 63,410. So, and probably if you want to say, just off the top of my head, about 5,000 items per month. So that would be 56,000 plus another 15,000 would be matching to this above 63,000 over last year.
And that's just for winter, or is that just?
That's Hayward. Is 56,000.
The Sawyer County.
Hayward.
Not LCO.
Nope, just ours.
Okay.
And that's through the end of October. Thank you. Sorry.
Thank you. Okay. Anybody else have any comments, questions? Okay. If not, we're adjourned. Thanks, everyone. See you next month.